Good evening, everyone.
Hello, Paul.
It's great to see you. I'm seeing a lot of familiar faces just from our last live event. Hi, Kathy, how you doing? So
Hey, Paul.
I'm really excited to kick off this new live event with all of you. And instead of you looking, I want to do a quick introduction about the Guitar Brigade and our two facilitators. But instead of you looking at this, I'm going to give you something else to look at here. So just give me a second while I grab the screen. Give you a little Tom Petty motivation here. So the whole idea of doing a guitar brigade is, loosely defined, a brigade is a body of troops organized for a specific purpose. And we have a specific purpose tonight, and that's why we're launching the guitar brigade. We really have kind of a dual purpose of the brigade. We want to continue learning together that we really enjoy, and we want to do it in kind of a supportive environment. And that's really what we're trying to do with the Guitar Brigade. Tonight's format is about a 45-minute lesson on the blues, and we want to make sure we're going to leave some time not just for Q&A, but we also want to talk to you about the brigade itself, the content you might want to see in the future, and even the format. We really want this to be participant driven, and we'll have to so be thinking about the content that you'd like to see and format changes you might like to see. And I'm going to come back to you now. Everyone get that great quote from Tom Petty there. All right, so tonight's facilitators, I want to introduce some two cool cats for you. The two facilitators for the brigade have between them have worked with over 40 guitar servette students and have almost 60 years of playing experience between them. Both Dave and Ken have a passion for teaching and obviously a deep respect for our veterans. Dave Crout, who is, I guess, depending on how you're seeing it, he's to my right. He's been playing guitar for some 36 years, and he began his affiliation with Guitar Servettes running the in-person chapter in North Carolina. And he's graduated over 14 students with us. He's relatively new to the cyber chapter, but he isn't new to teaching for Guitar Servettes. Little side story about Dave Crout, kind of the whole reason we're doing this was based on some emailing we were doing back and forth when Dave told me that after he graduates his students, he still offers to meet with them, and he had been meeting with a few of his students every month. So I said to Dave, that sounds like a great idea. What do you think about trying to do something like that for our virtual community where we could still make it about socializing around the guitar and maybe learning a little something? And so I'm thankful Dave said yes to that. And Ken Morlino has been with us not quite as long. I think he joined the cyber chapter in July of 23. He's graduated three students with us so far, but has been playing for a while. In fact, he's a multi-instrumentalist, starting way back in his childhood with the piano, and plays bass guitar and now acoustic guitar. So, without further ado, I think what we'll do is jump into the program. We'll leave time for questions. Use the chat feature if you can. Dave and I will be trying to keep an eye on that for you if you have questions about the blues as we kick this off. Ken.
Well, thank you, Paul, and thank all of you for attending. This is really an impressive turnout. We're pretty excited. We've been Dave, Paul, and I have been talking about this for a little while, so it's a few months for sure, and so it's really great to get it off the ground. And we want to make this interactive, so if you have questions or observations, or you have something to add, feel free to put it in the chat. We'll try to get to your questions as we move along. And I just want to reiterate what Paul said. This we're building the plane as we fly this, so to speak. So we don't have per se a finely tuned roadmap of the topics that we want to cover in future sessions. We really want to make that tailored to you. So we're going to have time at the end of the program to get your input as well. So we thought we'd start off by kind of a general discussion of the blues. So here's the, just let me just go over the little agenda here for tonight. We're going to provide like an overview of the blues. I'm going to talk and provide some characteristics of it. We're going to spend some time then after that looking at the 12-bar blues progression. For those of you experienced musicians, this might be pretty basic, but I think it's just to make sure that we have a foundation of the progression and what it's communicating and why it's needed and how useful it is. So we'll spend some time kind of looking at a progression and dissecting that a little bit. And then I think probably the funnest part is we're going to listen to three musical examples, and we're going to listen to each one, probably at least parts of it a couple of times. I'm going to try to point out some things. So, and my idea here is to get us to listen for some very specific things and to kind of point some things out. And then toward the end of the program, we'll just have finalize any questions and, of course, open discussion in terms of the brigade. So with that being said, why the blues, right? Why the blues? Probably first and foremost, as guitar players, it's probably that one of the most easiest, not easiest, but one of the most accessible ways of diving into tunes and playing tunes and making music, which is ultimately the idea. I don't know about you, but I'm not a very good singer. You know, for those of you who can sing and you can strum some chords and sing, and you're a complete one-man band. But for people that don't sing, like myself, playing tunes without vocals is the next best thing. And the blues is just a perfect example and the perfect vehicle for all guitar players, and especially beginning to intermediate guitar players, of getting more familiar with the fretboard, getting more familiar with keeping time, getting more familiar to playing inside the confines of a tune. So this is a very accessible tune format. And when we get to the actual progression, we'll take a look at that, and that hopefully will make a little more sense. So, you know, where does this thing, the blues, come from, right? So, the term the blues denotes what? Feeling down, feeling melancholy, right? Feeling low, feeling down, sadness. And that really derived this whole very quintessentially American musical genre. Originated in the United States Deep South with the African American slave community, and it evolved from their music that they brought with them from Africa, and from a culture of spiritual ballads and work songs. Another kind of aspect of the blues and how it got that name is that the music was played primarily in the early days by a single person with a guitar and singing and playing the guitar, as you know, for many of you know. It's an instrument where you can bend the notes, and in bending notes, you get a somewhat blue sound. It gets a little out of pitch. Okay, so so that's part of the term the blues, right? So this music started the late 18th century, and by the early 19th century, the early 1900s, it was actually being published as sheet music. At that point in time, more and more people were able to put a piano in their house, and which led to the explosion in the publishing industry of sheet music. And so blues as a formal tune on a piece of paper was becoming more and more available as the turn of this century. The blues is a musical expression of life's struggles and challenges, right? And so hence the term blues, which implies sadness and melancholy, feeling down. As a musical genre, when you say the blues, it's kind of like saying jazz, right? There's many, many genres, many, many different types of blues. There's this, the quintessential, you know, B.B. King, Johnny Lee Hooker, individual player, Albert King, more Southern style blues, right? And then as people migrated from the South into the North, in the cities of the North, okay, the country blues, then over time, being played by people who now live in more cities, became a more urban experience, and led to genres like the Chicago blues, the St. Louis blues, okay? In terms of genre, our cousins across the pond, the British, in the late 50s, early 60s. Paul, if you might, you want to,
jump. That.
Yeah, that's fine. You can even take that off if you want. The British pop scene, and I, from looking at the pictures of folks, a few of us remember like the mid to mid 60s and those bands like John Mayall and the Blues Breakers and early Led Zeppelin, all of which were blues based bands. They were listening to Albert King and Johnny Lee Hooker. The Rolling Stones was a blues band. So this genre just is you know, it's really ubiquitous in terms of what it's done for the music industry. And then ultimately, and this didn't take long, in the early 1900s, by 1917 is the actual first recording of a tune that was more ragtime, which led into jazz. So in terms of anyone who's studied or played jazz, you don't get there without a firm understanding of the blues. And so, you know, this is just a real, real essential music, American musical genre, to which we owe a lot as musicians and pretend, right? So what are some of the characteristics of the music itself, right? There's a couple of different forms, and we're going to talk about form here in a minute. 8 bars or 12 bars. Many of the early blues tunes were 8 bars, which evolved into a 12-bar form or progression. Okay. In terms of lyricism, the blues kind of follows a pattern where a person makes a statement, which is the first 4 bars of the tune. They sing repeat that statement a second time, and then there's a resolve. And we're going to hear a couple examples of that. In terms of harmony, so again, just to be sure everyone's on the same page, you know, when we sing happy birthday to you, that's the melody, right? The harmony is the underlying chord structure. So the harmony can be played with 3 note chords like triads, but generally it's with a seventh chord. And what it means, a seventh chord, we'll circle back and cover that here in a minute. So that's some of the kind of basic characteristics of the blues. I'd like to stop and just check in and see if there's any questions or observations.
We did have a question, Ken, from Tim. He's asking, is the country genre mostly based off of the blues?
I don't know if it's mostly based. I think it's the Caucasian version is what I would say, right? Because the country music started, you know, in places like Appalachia. But I'm not, I don't know a lot. I can't speak much about country music per se. I think that's a great question. Maybe someone else has some thoughts on that.
Well, I didn't even see it there that your accomplice, Dave, said, yes, country music also is derived from the blues like jazz. And so, yeah, it's got its roots. Gary also said he had the honor to talk with Tim Kelly, a guitarist for Slaughter. certainly before shortly before he passed away, and he asked him what I should listen to as a beginning guitarist. This was in the mid-90s, and his answer was, listen to the blues. He should have said, listen to the Beatles. That would have been a good answer too, but listen to the blues is a phenomenal answer. And well, I think what you're going to learn tonight is that the blues represents a formula. And that's really, for a guitar player, that formula is, it's really powerful when you start hearing it in other songs and other genres, or when you start creating music, having that formula and understanding that is really helpful.
Yeah, thanks, Paul. Let me ask Dave, because Dave's been playing the guitar, I think, for 36 years. So Dave, how has playing the blues influenced you as a musician, and what are your thoughts on it?
Yeah, I just like the rhythm of the blues, for one thing. And it always, you know, lured me in to want to be, you know, play that type of rhythm. But one of the most things that it's helped me with along the way too is how to improvise, because it taught, since there's, you're only dealing with like three chords in the progression, it helped me learn to, like, instead of just running up and down the pentatonic scales soloing, it helped me to, like, pay more attention to what chord you're playing and the chord progression, and try to target that. You know, if I'm landing on if I'm playing an A chord while I'm trying to solo, where I'm hitting, you know, focusing on the A notes, or if I'm focusing on the E notes instead of just, you know, playing the scale. So it helped me learn that. So when I went to, like, more complicated chord progressions, I could take that, what I learned, like, in the blues, and apply it to other progressions. But I mean, I just love playing over the blues too. I mean, just, you know, with a background rhythm, it's a fun genre to solo over. So, but that, you know, so that's what helped me a lot with the blues. But I just, you know, always loved the blues.
Great. Well, thanks, Dave. So Paul, yeah, let's pull up the 12 bar progression. Let's take a little dive into that here.
And before we do that, I want to just, we got another comment that I think is great as we lead into the listening examples that we're going to do. Mike Manchester says, how do you make the statement and resolve it with just music? And that question, you know, we could spend probably another whole live event on that. But I think for tonight, you're going to be hearing us use numbers a lot when we're talking about the blues. And you're going to hear 1-4-5. And that's just referring to the root note, the fourth chord in the key family, and the fifth chord. So if we're in the key of, say, A is the 1, D is the 4, E is the 5. The quick answer to that question, Mike, if you play the D chord and you go to the 5, which is an E, or excuse me, an A chord, I don't want to confuse you. If you play an A chord and go to the 5, which is an E, but make that an E7, that 5 resolving back to the A is kind of what we talk about with the tension. So generally the 5 chord, when you make it a 7, gives a lot of tension before going back home to the A chord. And you're going to hear examples of that as Ken has prepared this. A lot of these blues use the same formula, and that's usually going from that 5 to that 1 chord as a big resolution. So that's kind of one way that music talks about doing that. Let me grab the screen here real quick.
Yeah, and I'll take a stab at, because Mike's question, I think, if I understand, Mike, correct us if I'm wrong. You're asking, how do we do that in a tune where we're not singing, right? Is that what you're, good. So basically so if we pull up when we take a look at that progression, it's going to help me address this specifically.
Do you want me to bring up the audio sample?
Please. No, the progression and the 12 bar progression,
gotcha. Right.
in the presentation.
Gotcha. Let me grab that.
Okay, so hang on, Mike. I'm gonna come back to that. Okay, so here we go. You're looking at the 12 bar blues form or progression. The words form and progression are used synonymously. form in terms of music is a general cachet of the roadmap of the song. Like Broadway standards are often a 32-bar tune or 64. 12-bar form, so that's the basic roadmap is 12 bars. But you can also talk about it as in terms of a progression, because a progression indicates how is the chord movement going. Okay, so let's take a look at what we're looking at. We're looking at three sets of lines with divided into groups of four. So the top line has four, the middle line has four, the bottom line four. Each one of those sections is a measure of music. You know what? I think I need the next slide, please. Not that.
Not that one?
Oh, you know what? I'm sorry. Never mind. It's in the handout. Never mind. There is a handout that is on the CAVARTS site. Can you go back to the last one, Paul?
Yeah, I think I got to go.
That's fine. We don't have to go there. Okay. So, so each one of these groups of four, each one is a measure. So there's four measures in each set of four lines, three lines, 12 measures. Okay. At the beginning, at the end, you see a dark kind of curly line with two dots. That means repeat. So that's a sign that we're going to start and we just keep looping this. We repeat it. Okay. We see Roman numerals and the number seven. So the Roman numerals 1, 4, and 5 indicate we're using the chords 1, 4, and 5 of the key. The 7 indicates that it's a 7th chord. Now, we're not going to get into chord harmony tonight. We're thinking that the next session, if it's on, you know, trouble, we'll introduce triads, we think. And then from there, that would be the next logical place is beyond the triad, which is the first 1, 3, and 5 of the chord. We add the 7th note to make a 7th chord. We'll take a look in a minute at what chords in a specific key. So basically, again, I know this is basic for a lot of you. The form is 12 bars. There's 12 measures of music. We use the 1 chord in bar 1 to the 4 chord in bar 2, back to the 1 and 3, 1 and 4, back to the 4 chord for bars 5 and 6, back to the 1 chord for 7 and 8, the 5 chord in bar 9 to 4 and 10, 1, and then 5. And bar 12, which brings us back to 1. As Paul mentioned, the 5 chord of the tune adds tension. And in Western music, the 5 chord as a tension chord wants to resolve to its home, which is the 1 chord. So I'll pick the key of C because that's the easiest. It's the white keys on the piano. The notes C, D, E, F, G, A, and B, right? So if we're in the key of C, the 1 chord is C, the 4 chord is C, D, E, F, 4, and the 5 chord is G. So in a C blues, it would be C 7th, F 7th, and G 7th, okay? Now, again, there are variations of in terms of harmony. Sometimes the you don't go to the 4 chord in bar 1. You might have 4 bars of the first, just the root chord 1. So again, there are some variations. Let's take a look at a specific key. Paul, can you go to the next slide then? Okay, here we go. So here's the 12 bar blues in A. Same exact progression, just a little bit more information. Okay. We have a repeat sign at the very end. It's a slightly different, but it's that's the same idea of the repeat sign. You have the chord charts, which I suspect all of you can read. So we're in the key of A. So if it's A, B, C sharp, and D, and E, so A is my 1, A, B, C sharp, D is my four, and E is my five. And so 1-4, A7 to D7, back to 1, A7, A7, to the 4 chord, bars 5 and 6, D7, D7, back to the 1 chord in 7 and 8, A7, E7 is bar 9, to D7, to the root, A7 and 11, and then back to the 5 chord for the tension, which is also known as the turnaround, because you're turning around back to the beginning of the song. So this is the roadmap for the tune. It's really helpful to have a roadmap so we know where we are. If I get lost, if I lose my playing and I lose my place, the music keeps moving forward. And if in time, hopefully, if I have a roadmap, I can wait and I can say, okay, we're approaching, sounds like we're going to approach bar 9. Well, that would be, in this case, it would be an E7. Right. So the roadmap is like really essential. If you're not used to using one, the blues is the perfect way to start kind of looking at that roadmap as a chord progression, and gives you the outline of where to follow. So let's stop, see if there's any questions before we listen to a couple of examples.
Yeah, there are some questions out here, Ken. Steve Kimball is saying, living in Tennessee, I'm surrounded by country and blues, Nashville and Memphis. And
yes,
I'm not familiar with either genre. How does the folk rock like Simon and Garfunkel, Peter, Paul, and Mary relate into these types?
I'm going to let Paul might be able to better answer this than I, but I don't know that they are significantly like related. I think they derive, they're more what's considered more popular tunes, correct? I mean, I think if you ask Paul Simon, he would probably say that blues had a strong influence on his ability as a musician and a songwriter. But I don't, in terms of the progressions are a little slightly different.
Yeah, and
my question was on the fact that I'm more interested in the coffee house type songs that Simon and Garfunkel, Peter, Paul, and Mary, Bob Dylan, those early 60s artists were playing at the time.
Okay.
I can't do it off the top of my head, but I can give you some Simon and Garfunkel and Peter, Paul, and Mary songs that are 1-4-5 chord progression. So kind of what we're learning from the blues, I think the example I used in CAVARTS was the Beatles' birthday song. It's a 1-4-5 in A, and it follows almost to the T, the diagram that Ken had up. And I wouldn't call that a blues song. I mean, that had a nice little rock riff to it. And so what we're doing with pop and a lot of these genres is we're making a lot of songs that include the root, the fourth, and the fifth. So it's not blues when it first hits your ear. I mean, you don't necessarily think of Peter, Paul, and Mary as the blues people. But their songs, I know, Puff the Magic Dragon has a B minor in there, so that's probably not a good example. But all of them have in their repertoire, I would say, 1-4-5 chord progressions. And Kathy asks, when we talk about making a seventh chord out of the root, the third, and the fifth, is it a dominant seven or a major seven?
Yeah, so is a Kathy, is a dominant seven. The five chord is termed dominant. It is a seventh because the seventh is, well, the dominant has a flat seven versus the major seventh that you asked about. A seventh chord just means it's got the first, the third, the fifth, and the seventh note of the scale in it. When we start playing chords, we're playing C, which is C, E, and G. A C seventh would be C, E, G, and B. So a major seventh is the natural seventh of the scale. The dominant is the flat seventh. I didn't anticipate, it's a great question. And we want to get there. We didn't want to get too much into scale theory with with this opening session, but it's an awesome question and thanks for asking it. And I want to circle back to Mike because I didn't answer his question. So Paul, could you just pull up the progression again, just real quick?
And actually, while he's doing that, Kathy, yeah, the dominant seventh is really one whole step below the root, and the major seventh is one half step below the root.
Do you want this one, Ken, or the actual?
The one before. Okay, so you asked how would I do this without singing? And I think that this is the easiest way. The first four bars, you would play some kind of lick or line. Ideally, you're going to use a scale that's going to lend itself to like a blues scale or minor pentatonic, which has a bluesy, sad tune. You would repeat that same line again and through bars four and bars five through eight. So statement, statement, and then in bars 9 through 12, you're going to take that line and you're going to resolve it. You're going to change it up. So you could try playing that. And there's all kinds of blues progressions on YouTube in every key. Slow, fast. It's just an amazing resource. So let's listen to a couple of examples, okay? We're gonna start with a more traditional American bluesman, Johnny Lee Hooker. Let's listen to just Paul, play the beginning, play like the first up to about 110. That gets us through three choruses of the form. And we'll stop at that point. And then I just want to point out some things. As you're listening, just see if you can feel the tempo. Okay, so we'll go back to the beginning. So let's kind of break this down. You'll notice he plays for a while before he starts singing. So he plays the form once, or the band plays the form once, right? So they're going to go through the progression.
When you say that, Ken, does that mean 12 bars passed before he starts singing? Okay.
Yes, right? Okay. In terms of tempo, if you clock this on a metronome, it's about 124. It's about this tempo. So what I'm going to do this time, I'm going to just count the bars as they go by. So I'll just do this. Okay. So let's try it again. And listen to that first 12, and then when he comes in, and see if you can stay with him as he goes from bar 1 to 2, the 4, 1 to 5, 4 chord, the 5 chord in bar 12. But just mostly I want you to feel the rhythm, and I'll just count out the bars. I'll say it vocally and I'll hold up a finger. Three, Well, turn around. One.
One bourbon, one scotch, and one bill. One bourbon, one scotch, and one bill. Hey, Mr. Bartender, come here. I want another drink and I want...
12, turn around. Good, okay. The other reason I picked this tune out is this also has a shuffle feel. And so just very, very quickly, generally you one and two and three and four, just half straight chord, straight eighth notes, one and two and three and four. Okay. If we play that, broke that down into three, one, two, three, four, yatta-da, 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 and we take out the middle. It's yatta-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. That's a shuffle feel. You can hear that with what the drummer's doing, kind of, and the drummer's also accenting beats two and four. So let's do it one more time. See if you can identify that shuffle. And see if you can hear the drummer on beats two and four, one, two, three, four, what he's doing. Any comments, questions? I hope we could hear that.
Yeah, Dave, are people hearing it okay?
Yeah, looks like people are hearing it.
Good. All right, let's try the next one then.
I don't know why, but after listening to that, Ken, I'm thirsty.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. So this one, Jimi Hendrix, okay? This is a much slower tune. The tempo is about 68. Okay. What's going to happen here? There's a four bar intro, and this one, they're playing the last four bars of the tune. So in terms of the progression, it would be bars 9, 10, 11, and 12. 12 is a turnaround back to the top one. So that's what's happening here. This is a great example of the statement, and the resolving statement that the singer makes. So let's give this one a shot. Here's the top. One. Also a shuffle feel. Also has a shuffle feel. Can you keep going? Repeat the statement.
Lord, there's a red house over yonder. Lord, that's where my baby stays.
So the drum again is accenting the two and the four? And when you say that, that's the loudest, the two and the four are the loud beats you're hearing on the
drum.
Well,
he's hitting the snare drum really hard.
And on a straight shuffle, would it just, you would have an even, like on a one and two versus two and four?
No, the shuffle is da, da, da. I'm just saying in terms of the keeping the tempo, the drummer, you know, he's really accenting beats two and four. on that snare drum. So let's go. I want to hear a statement resolution again. So this is, because this is classic. You know, the statement, you know, my dog died, I'm so lonely. My dog died, I'm so lonely. My dog lied, I'm so lonely, I can cry, I'm going to go get drunk. You know, that kind of thing. Statement, and then the resolution.
Do you want me to start from the beginning?
Not the very beginning, just like the, I mean, you can go just before he starts singing. And then he resolves it by saying something about, I don't think my baby lives here anymore. So, all right. So the one more example, this looks at, if any of you listen to jazz, then you know that the blues is kind of the backbone of jazz. So this is a Miles Davis, right? Pretty prolific jazz player. This is a blues tune. What I want you to listen to is, we're going to play the what's called the head, and that has a different feel, and then it kind of sounds like it changes tempo. So let's go through it one time, and then I'll try to point a couple of things out.
When you say one time, it says it's 11 minutes long.
No. It starts in one kind of,
all right,
what feels like one tempo, and then it changes. And then I'm going to talk about that. This is a blues form. So what happens here, it's a 12-bar blues form, and they play what's called the head or the melody twice. Da 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 da, right? It's in a two feel. So listen to what the bass player is doing while they play the melody, and around the 35-second mark, when they go, after the second time, they go into a more traditional 1-2-3-4 pattern. It's actually, the tempo doesn't change, but when it goes, when it's in two feel, it feels a little slower, and then it goes to a more traditional 1-2-3-4. So let's see if you can hear that. Go back to the beginning, Paul. So this is a two feel. It's still 1-2-3-4-2. is all 12 bar blues. All right, now we're out of the three. One, two, three, four. All right, Paul, that's good. Thank you. So I really picked this one because it's relatively accessible as far as jazz goes, but it's 12 bar blues. Statement, resolution, all 12 bar blues. So that's my part, what I've prepared. We're ready to open the floor, I think, Paul. Questions and comments, and I hope you all found that worth 45 minutes of your time.
Yeah, so let me scroll up the slides. I know we posted in CAVARTS the handout, and that is there. It also has links to all the videos that we just played. And Ken added additional website resources. So the PDF is right now in the community, and that would be what you'd want to get. How does a 12 bar differ from 8 bars? That's actually a good question by four, I think.
Yeah, it's just a shorter version. What's the classic 8 bar? Key to the Highway. Listen to Key to the Highway. Eric Clapton has a great version, but that's an old blues tune. That's actually an 8 bar blues.
Steven's asking about relating the 12 bar blues to an acoustic form.
Can we elaborate on that? Can we elaborate? Can we unmic them?
Yeah. I'm strictly playing an acoustic guitar. These artists that you're demonstrating are playing electric form. How do I transfer that into my simple six string non-electric machine?
Well, I mean, anything you can do on an electric, you can kind of do on acoustic. It's not quite as some things are not as easy. But I would start with just getting the chords down in time in the form, and then maybe connecting those chords. So you can start by strumming the chords, right? 1, 2, 3, 4. Once you get that down, you can vary the pattern. You can introduce them single notes, say if we're in the key of A, where we're moving from A7 to D7, right? You could strum a couple of bars, a couple of beats 1, 2, 3 on A7, and then walk into a D7 using single note lines. Is this kind of answering your question?
I've just opened another can of worms for me.
Yeah, I mean, it's a lifelong journey on the guitar. Other thing I was going to say, Ken, is for acoustic guitar, there's actually like almost a genre called acoustic blues. And it's very, a lot of hand picking, and that's where a lot of the rhythm, the shuffle type things come in. In the 10-hour outline that we have for Guitar Servettes, one of the things we do in one of the very late lessons is just a very simple, in the key of E, a blues shuffle, just because it's fun to play on an acoustic guitar. But a lot of the bluegrass that's built off of 1-4-5s and blues on the acoustic is another aspect to the acoustic guitar. It's about 9:19. There's a couple questions about folks not being able to find handouts. So what I'm going to do real quick is take over the screen, and we're all going to go into CAVARTS together. And I'll show you exactly where this is, because it's hanging in there forever. All right, you guys seeing my screen?
Yeah.
So I'm just in CAVARTS when I'm just at the feed. And the way the feed is usually is it's whatever was commented on most recently, not the latest post, but Steven commented on this 2 minutes ago. So that's on top. So if we scroll down to Ken, put in right here is a PDF for the Guitar Servettes Blues lesson, the handout. So you'll see all of the stuff we covered, as well as the diagram and the links to we had several other song examples. We used this one in the community, and we didn't cover all of them necessarily. And he had some websites there. So again, if I could find where the heck I'm at here, if I could back out of here, when you're in CAVARTS, just go to the feed and then scroll down to find, use Ken's name. It's going to be the one that he did, and you'll be able to find the G4V Blues Session handout.
Paul, I'm going to repost that because I think that might be the handout where the links didn't come over.
I updated listening. It. I updated.
Oh, you did? Oh, super. Great. Yeah. Great.
All right. How are we doing on questions?
I think we covered most of them from what I can see here.
So I'm going to say maybe you all should unmute and we should just kind of talk a little bit about right now what we have set up for the Guitar Brigade is February 21st. Is that right? That's always going to be our third Wednesday of the month. So February 21st. And Ken or Dave and Ken have a few ideas that they want to prepare around, but we kind of want to pause here, hear from you on if there's two types of information we want to get from you, topics you want us to cover in the future, and or if there's a different format you want us to consider when we're using, when we're doing the brigade. So this format was loosely 60 minutes together, about a 40, 45 minute lesson, and then kind of the Q&A. But again, we are very flexible to opening this up and hearing from you what you liked about it, what you didn't like about it, and what you want us to consider for future live events.
Looks like some people are unmuted, Paul.
We can unmute ourselves.
Perfect. Any feedback for us?
I'd enjoy some playing, a little bit of playing, probably at the end. As a lesson, you know, what you've taught us and then go through it once together.
I'm going to put you on the spot, Ken or Dave. Would either of you be willing to do just like a blues shuffle on the guitar? Just a real simple blues shuffle?
Yeah, I can give it a shot. Yeah, so that was Dan that asked that question. Yeah, definitely, you know, if there was when we put this together, we recognize we don't want to bite off too much, but I fully have prepared the blues part two already, which would get more into blues scale, you know, you connecting chords through individual notes and that kind of thing. So, you know, there could definitely be more playing live together. I think, correct me if I'm wrong, Paul.
Yeah, no, I think Dan's just asking about an application, to be able to see a guitarist doing something with the blues versus us jamming together. And I think that's a great idea, Dan, for future live events. We always try and mix it up to give you a couple different ways to view the lesson, and the physical hands-on application is an important one.
I'll give it a shot, but I need a second. So.
All right. Any other questions while Ken's getting ready?
Well, excuse me. This is Bob Richardson.
Hey, Bob.
Hi. You had mentioned the fact that you already have blues lesson number two. And earlier, there was mention of using an E minor or a minor pentatonic scale. For maybe lesson three, you can talk about how you would identify what minor scales to use with a particular blues progression.
Sure.
Yeah, and I think what we're asking the larger community, I mean, there's obviously so many different roads that we could go mm-hmm. down, and we're just on the blues road. There's so many other different things we could do. So I think the idea of a blues two came up with, there's just so much more to explore with this topic. And if we want to continue with blues, that would certainly be one way to do that. Hey, Ken, I'm going to tell you what I tell all my students. You're a very handsome man, but can you put the guitar down, the webcam down a little bit so we could see her? Yeah, thanks.
So you wanted to demonstrate a shuffle?
Yeah. Yeah.
So if we just do... just straight quarter notes. sorry, now we'll do eighth notes. One and, right? So here's a shuffle. So you hear the difference between shuffle, straight, shuffle, and that is that.
Yeah, that.
Yeah, but go through a whole 12 bars if you could.
Yep. Bar five. Four chord, six, seven, eight, nine, 12, one.
Very nice, very nice. Thank you. And hey, I want to thank Dave and Ken for sticking their necks out and offering to do this for us. I really appreciate it. Use the community to give us feedback as well, and we'll get to work on next month's Guitar Brigade. And if there's no other burning questions at all, I want you all have a great night, and thanks for joining us.
Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you for coming.
Thank you.
Good night, everyone.